Hi students, so in this session we are going to learn the functions of operating system. But before that, goals of operating system we need to remember. Okay, so let us consider today's topic as goals of operating system and as well as functions of operating system. So actually, goals of operating system, we are going to divide into two, primary goal and secondary goal. Based upon the definition, the primary goal of operating system is ease of work, convenience. Simply we can say the primary goal of operating system is convenience. The secondary goal here is efficiency. Okay, so convenience in the sense, whenever we use, why we are considering convenience as primary goal in the sense, whenever we use any particular application, first of all we should use and then we should expect the efficiency. So that's why every time we are going to consider convenience as primary goal, the secondary goal as efficiency. If you want to implement, if operating system want to reach these two goals, it should perform some functions. So let us consider one example. Our short-term goal is to know the details of operating systems and to get good marks in exam. This is our short-term goal. What we need to perform, what are type of actions we need to perform to get good marks in exam, in a sense, every time we are going to work out on the subject, each and every topic we need to learn and remember, and then we are going to present our knowledge in the examination exams. Okay, so whatever the work we are going to perform to reach that particular goal, that work is nothing but functions. So what type of task we are going to perform, okay, what type of actions we are going to perform, okay, what are the measures we are going to consider, okay, all these nothing but the functions in that same way. So how we are preparing, what are the schedule and what type of topics we need to consider, okay, what are the practice session we are going to maintain, all these are nothing but the task we are going to implement to reach our goal, that is nothing but getting good marks in the exam. So from this example, you just match the same example with our operating system goals and functions. Okay, operating system goal is should specify the convenience environment and it should get the efficiency factors also. To reach these two factors, it is going to perform, that means operating system need to perform some functions. Okay, so let us consider what are the goals and functions in operating system we are having. Every time we need to consider what are the primary goal and secondary goal we are having, that is operating system having, okay, and what are the necessary actions need to be performed. Okay, like that every time we need to consider. Okay, goals of operating system. The goals of operating system, so the primary goal here is should provide user-friendly environment and convenient environment, and the secondary goal here is efficiency. So you just consider the types of operating systems here, which one having user-friendliness and which one having convenience, and in which one we can get the efficiency. In the previous session, we are having two types of operating system, that is Unix operating system and as well as Windows operating system. Even the Unix having the security measures are more when compared to our Windows operating system. But most of the users is going to use the Windows only. Why? Because if you want to see any particular movie in Windows, no need to write any particular program. We are going to just click on that particular icon. That means which one is more convenient, which one is more user friendly in the sense, Windows is more user friendly. Then we are going to calculate the efficiency factors. Okay? Even though Unix having the efficiency factors more when compared to the Windows, but the convenience environment in which we are providing more in the sense, the Windows itself. Like that, we need to compare the goals. but whatever it may be, so whatever the action we are performing, okay, every time we need to keep in mind. So the major goal here is we need to provide user-friendly environment. And the next secondary goal here, we need to provide the efficiency factors itself. Okay, so and to fulfill these particular goals, here some functions need to be performed via operating system. To achieve the goals of this operating system need to perform the following functions. Those are nothing but some process management, user interface, okay, memory management, I/O management, file management, virtual memory, all these are nothing. Okay, here user interface in the sense in which manner we are, in which platform we are going to provide to the user to perform, to fulfill his task. Okay, whether we are going to perform the command line interface or we are going to give some graphical user interface, that depends upon the type of operating system. And based upon the type of operating based upon the interface, the usage is going to be different. Along with this, in the further units also, we are going to learn how I/O management is going to be performed, how file management, virtual management, how it is going to be performed. But the major issues in these functions are process management and memory management. These two are very, very important. Okay, and how we can, how operating system is going to perform process management in the sense, this is the information. So whenever we submit any particular input to the system, that means suppose I just write one particular program and I just want to get one particular result, okay, that program need to convert it into execution state. That program under execution stage can be treated as a process, right? Process management in the sense, how many number of processes that CPU need to execute, okay? So which process need to be transferred to the CPU first and which process need to be transferred next to the CPU. Like that, here we are having some group of process CPU need to be executed. Okay, in which order the process need to be transferred to the CPU, that is very important. The scheduling is going to be performed by our operating system itself. Okay, so here there is in this particular diagram we are having some number of process one, process two, process three, and so on. Okay, and then we are having some job scheduler, and then we are having process scheduler. Job scheduler is going to hold the newly arrived process, and whereas this process scheduler is going to give ready to execute. Suppose in the first time cycle, CPU is going to say one process is assigned to the CPU and it is in under in a execution process. Then the next process should wait in the queue itself. Okay, whenever number of process is going to be generated and CPU need to execute each and every process just with the allocation of resources, all these. Okay, so what, how many number of process we are having, which process need to enter into execution stage, in which second the particular process entered into execution stage. Before going to enter into execution stage, process need to be in waiting state only. Okay, job scheduler is going to hold the newly arrived process. Okay, that means it should enter into CPU. If that process enter into CPU, it should wait for some time. Why? Because the CPU is already in working state. So whenever the current work is going to be finished, then only new process is going to be assigned to the process. Okay, so the job scheduler is going to hold all the process itself. Okay, in a queue manner. And then the process scheduler, it is nothing but ready queue. Ready queue is nothing but this process. All the resources are going to be allotted and this process we can transfer to the CPU. And CPU can ready to execute that particular process. This is very, very important. Just with the support of our scheduling algorithms, we can able to perform the process management. In the sense here, the operating system is going to perform all the process execution itself. Once the request is going to be converted, okay, once the request is going to be converted into execution stage, so first of all, process need to allocate all the resources itself. If all the resources are available, then only the process is going to be entered into execution stage. What is a resource in the sense? So memory allocation is one of the resources. CPU time cycle allotment is one of the time resource. Okay. All the hardware specifications, all these are nothing but hardware devices, memory specifications, and then as well as CPU time cycle, all these are nothing but the resources. if there is any unavailability of any resource, the process need to be in waiting state itself. Okay, so all the processes should be assigned with the available resources, and then it is transferred into execution stage. Goal itself specifies, so it should wait for some time to get all the resources. When a process get executed, in the sense, and all the resources are available and assigned to the process, then it is ready to execute. Then ready process is going to be maintained under the process scheduler. Scheduler, in the sense, in which time cycle which process need to be entered into execution. Okay, so CPU performs process by process work itself. Okay, so only one process can be allotted to the CPU at a time. So if suppose our process is not stored in the main memory, then it is not in the ready queue. All the resources are assigned to each and every process, then it is in the ready queue. So automatically the ready queue information is transferred to the processor itself. Okay, so process management, in the sense, how many number of processes arrived in which time, how many number of resources need to be allotted to each and every process, and which process need to enter into the CPU, in which time the process need to enter into CPU, how many number of seconds that process should be in execution stage. This is also very important. Okay, so how many number of seconds it is in execution stage, in which time cycle the process need to enter into execution stage, if any process need to enter into execution stage, all the resources are assigned to the process itself. If any resources is unavailable for any process, it is in the waiting state only. Once all the resources are allotted, then only the process is transferred into the execution stage. This is some information about process management. In the further units, we can get some more in detail specification. The details are in detail specification, just with the support of our scheduling algorithms itself. Okay, so process, in that sense, program under execution. Here process management, in the sense, so how many number of processes are arrived, okay, how many processes are in hold, that is job scheduler. That means the process is waiting for resource. Once all the resources are assigned to the process, then it is ready to execute. Whenever time cycle is going to be encountered to the specified process, automatically from ready queue to the execution, the process converted into ready queue to the execution stage. This is about some process management. And then memory management. This is actually one of the major important issue. Okay, and one of the important resource also. So if any process need to enter into execution stage, well, first of all, that process information should be in the main memory. Okay, this is also one of the major resource. So whatever the information available in the main memory, let's suppose the processor stored in main memory, only that processor processed by our CPU. Why? Because CPU is going to access the details from main memory only. It doesn't consider any secondary memory. So cache memory details is going to be accessed by CPU, and as well as main memory details is going to be accessed by our CPU. Okay, this is very, very important. So once our process information is stored in the memory, then only the next further process is going to be continued. Okay, like allocation of another resources or converted into some execution stage, whatever it may be. So if that process is stored in the main memory, then should maintain the base address and limit address. That is nothing but it indicates the size of process. Okay, how much space, how much amount of space in the main memory the process is going to occupy. Okay, so and what is the available memory we're having. So up to now we have stored how many number of process? 3 process. Process 1, process 2, process 3. And what is the size of process 1? Here we are going to indicate some base address and limit address. And what is the empty space we are having? That means how many number of processes are stored in main memory, how much amount of space is used, and how much amount of space is in free. Then only operating system is going to identify how many number of future processes is going to be stored in main memory. If main memory is full, then where we are going to store the process information, in a sense, with the help of our secondary storage devices. Okay, but whatever the data, whatever the process information we are storing, CPU is going to accept the details from main memory itself. It is a responsibility of main memory. So is there any process information outside the main memory, then it is the responsibility of that main memory to gather the details from secondary memory to the main memory. Okay, but whatever it may be, first of all, the process information should be stored in main memory, then only CPU is going to accept the details. At the current time cycle, the process is entered into execution, the process information is transferred, process information is going to be accepted from main memory itself. Okay, so main memory management is nothing but how much available space we are having, how many number of process we need to store, what is the available space in future, how many number of process we are going to store. Why? Because from this main memory only the information is going to be transferred to the CPU. And then the next function here is IO management. IO management, in a sense, all the peripheral devices which are connected to our system should be in. Suppose I just place a request from our keyboard, and keyboard is one of the peripheral device, and the programs is going to be in active state from main memory. So from this keyboard, we have submitted some information, and that information should be stored in the memory itself. IO management, in a sense, okay, what are the IO devices we are going to use with the current CPU? Okay, so what are the requested data, and that requested data should be stored in memory, and from this memory CPU is going to perform the processing details itself. This is very important related to IO commands itself. Okay, so here also there is an involvement of operating system. Okay, so the identification of device and current program need to be executed with the specification of memory. Okay, then only the CPU is going to identify the information. Okay, so IO management, in a sense, what are the different peripheral devices connected to the process, so from which device the input is going to be transferred, to which device the output need to be transferred. This is nothing but some IO. So input and output specifications, from which devices we are user is going to place request, or to which device the output need to be transferred. With the support of these IO commands, the work is going to be continued. Okay, and the next one is file management. So basically here each and every point of information that should be stored in memory, we are saying. Okay, so this information is going to be in a structured format internally. Okay, so this root directory, directory 1, directory 2, directory, all these is going to specify a particular order to arrange our details. Let's suppose consider one example. So I just gave one assignment to you. Okay, so the subject name is OS. Under OS, you just create some six files. The first file is unit 1. So under unit 1, you just create some four files related to each and every concept. Okay, that is basics of operating system. Commands related to that, means services of operating system, functions of operating system, and goals of operating system, like that. Okay, that means OS is our root directory. From that root directory, directory 1 is unit 1. From unit 1, what type of files we are considering? Concept, each a concept 1, concept 2, concept 3. Okay, like that we are arranging the overall information in a particular order. Why? Because whenever we are going to search any information, it is very easy whenever we arrange the information in a particular order. If you are not arranging the information in an order, then if you want to search for any point of information, it should take some lot of time. Okay, so to make our work easy, we are going to arrange each and every point of information. That means if we consider file management under OS point of view, okay, so what are the input devices we are having, what are the output devices we are having, what are the resources available to our system. Okay, so how we are going to specify the details, in which order, what are the related tasks we are having, okay, the subdirectory, what are the related tasks we are having, okay, how many number of files we are going to arrange in the memory, to which category it relates to, that each and every file to which category it relates to, the overall information is going to be arranged in a particular order. That is nothing but our file management itself. Okay, and then virtual memory. So here virtual memory, in the sense, in the previous slide we have discussed, if main memory is full, if suppose some data is not available in this particular main memory, compulsory the data should be stored in the connected secondary storage. Whenever CPU places a request for current data, if that data is not available in main memory, then it is the responsibility of main memory unit. From secondary storage, the requested data should be transferred to main memory, and from this main memory, the details should be transferred to the CPU. Okay, so usage of secondary storages, and we are going to place the details in main memory. Okay, what actually we are doing is we are working. That means we are working with the data which is not in main memory, but we are placing the data which is stored in secondary storage for temporary purpose. How can we store, in the sense, with the support of two operations from secondary storage? In this diagram, this one represents the secondary storage and this particular blocks represents the main memory. Okay, here program A, program B. How can we transfer the details? Okay, program A, it should contain the blocks 4, 5, 6, 7. Swap out, in the sense, when we use secondary storage devices, means whenever the main memory is full. Okay, even though the main memory is full, if you want to store some additional information which is required by the CPU, that details are stored in secondary storage. So program A related details here is the blocks are 4, 5, 6, 7. Program A is stored in 4 blocks, but we just want to store the block information. Program B need to be stored in the main memory, but there is no space in the main memory. Then what we are doing here is program A swapped out from main memory to the secondary memory. Swap out, in the sense, from main memory we are erasing the data and we are writing the data into the secondary. Swap out, in the sense, from main memory we are deleting the items. Swap in the sense, with respect to main memory, outside data is going to be stored in memory. Outside data, in the sense, the secondary storage data, whatever the data reside in the secondary storage, that data is going to be stored in the main memory. Storing, loading information into main memory is nothing but swap in. Okay, avoiding the data or deleting data or erasing the data from main memory to the secondary is nothing but swap out. With the help of these two operations, the data items make it available to the CPU at the right time. Okay, actually the data items are not reside in the main memory, but we are making it as available with the help of these two operations, and these operations comes under our virtual memory. Okay, actually the items are not in main memory, but we are making that these items are available in the main memory. Okay, this is about some virtual memory. So whenever you heard the term virtual memory, just remember the two operations, swap in and swap out. Okay, so when we use this swap in and swap out, in the sense, so whenever the data inavailability is identified in main memory, that means there is no space in main memory. So but we just want to transfer the details from main memory to the CPU. At this situation, we are going to include the secondary storage. The data which is stored in secondary storage are transferred to main memory. That is nothing but swap in. So if you want to store the additional amount of information in main memory, first of all we should free up the space. Okay, the free up the space from main memory to the secondary memory is nothing but our swap out operation. Okay, this is nothing but our virtual memory management. All these are nothing but the functions need to be performed by our operating system to reach the two goals, that is convenience and efficiency. Okay, before going to consider the services, okay, I just want to revise once again what are the goals of operating system, okay, and what are the functions related to the operating system. Before going to know about the services of operating system, so we just consider the goals. Goals, in the sense, so whenever operating system is reside in our system, okay, what are the major issues we need to provide to the user? here the goals are divided into two, primary goals and secondary goals. Primary goal here is convenience and the secondary goal here is efficiency. Why we are considering convenience as primary in the sense, whenever we use any particular one, whether it is an application or it is something else, once we use, then we identify, then we expect the efficiency. Okay, that's why we are considering every time the primary goal as convenience, the secondary goal as efficiency. To reach these two goals, operating system need to perform some functions, some actions. Okay, so here the major specifications are file management, process management, memory management, IO management, and virtual memory. These are the major functions need to be performed by our operating systems. Process and memory management, these two are very, very important. Why? Because so whenever the task is implemented by the user, whenever he posts any request to the system, so the actual work is divided into some number of processes, and that number of processes need to be stored in one particular scheduler. So scheduler itself specifies in which time which process need to enter into execution stage. So let us consider scheduler to get some more clarity on scheduler. Let us consider our class work. Okay, so from 10 o'clock to 4 o'clock we are having classes. So in which time, which class, how much amount of duration we are giving, this is nothing but the job of our job scheduler. Okay, so what is the starting time and what is the ending time and what is the duration of each and every subject? In the same way, in that is nothing but simply we can say our timetable, right? So in Monday, first 1 hour we are having some OS class. The second 1 hour we are having some CD. The next hour we are having some other class like that. So whenever CPU need to process any work or any task, so before going to perform the work of our CPU, operating system need to specify all the schedule details itself. Okay, how many number of processes we are having, what is the size of each and every process, how can we identify the size in a sense whenever it is stored in the memory itself. Okay, that is nothing but with respect to of our resources. So first of all it should be stored in memory, and after that the resources need to be allocated, and then we are going to transfer up to the CPU for performing processing. Okay, so if you just compare the job scheduler with our timetable, so each and every subject can be treated as process. The time duration is nothing but the execution period of the process. Okay, so in which time we need to in active state, in the sense whenever the resources are available, that means the particular teacher is in active state, the time state should be reached, then only we can conduct that particular class itself. Okay, so this is about some information related to our process management. How many processes we are having, what is the time period, what is the time cycle by the CPU, all these should be maintained. That is nothing but process management. Along with this, we should have some idea related to the memory management also. These two are very, very important when compared to the file management, IO management, all those. Okay, so memory management in the sense, what are the available space in the main memory, what is what actually we're having the space. Okay, how many process we need to store, what is the size of each and every process, and what is the base and limit address details. Base is nothing but at which address the process is going to be stored, from how many blocks it is going to occupy. Okay, and what is the actual size of that particular process. So based upon the size of process also, speed of operation is going to be dependent. All this comes under our services and functionalities also. Okay, but whatever it may be, we need to maintain our main memory in a perfect manner, the available limited available space. Okay, well, how many process we are going to store, size of each and every process, how much amount of space is occupied already, how much amount of space is in empty. This is very, very important. Okay, the next session we are going to consider the details related to our services, operating system services. Before going to close the second session, so just recollect the goals and as well as functions. Okay, so in that functions we need to learn what is process management and memory management. Along with these two, we are having file management, IO management, and as well as virtual memory. All these are actually, these are nothing but the concepts we are going to learn in detail in further units. But here we are going to see what actually the definition and representations are. Okay, so whatever it may be, so every time we need to remember what are the concepts we are learning in OS. Every time we need to remember the goals and as well as functions. So in that, the very important one is process management and memory management. Okay, once the details is going to be stored, then only the information is going to be processed. Okay, so that means all the available resources it is going to consider. Okay, once all the resources are allotted to the process, then it is ready to execute. Okay, how many number of processes we are having? So to identify each and every process, one ID is going to be created. So internally, based upon the process ID, each and every process is going to be identified, whether it is the process resources are allotted to the process or not, and it is transferred to the CPU or not, time slot is allotted to that process or not. Okay, internally, actually, process control block is also need to be known. That is nothing but in detail specification. In further units, we are going to identify what is the inter-process communication, what is process control block. All these are nothing but some more information related to the process management. But before that, in this first unit, regarding our first unit, we should learn what is actually a process is. Okay. So how the process information is managed and how the process information is transferred up to the CPU. Okay, this is very important issues we need to learn. Okay, and whatever the program we are submitting, when it is converted into execution stage, that execution stage program we are calling as a process. So how many number of processes we can expect in this sense? More number of processes itself. More than one process can be created at the same time. That once process is created, next stage here is it should be converted into threads, and then the threads is going to be executed by the CPU. Okay, that means what is job scheduler information, the types of schedulers. Okay, how the process is stored in the queue. Okay, and how from that queue, how can we transfer the process information up to the CPU? Okay, like that, that each and every point of information we should learn in further units. But in this unit, we should concentrate on there is some collection of process and there is some queue information. Okay, once the time slot is allotted to each and every process, once the CPU is free, the current execution is completed, then only new process is going to be entered into execution stage. Okay, like that, every time we need to remember all the details related to process. Each and every process can be identified by using process ID itself, and the size of process need to identify, and the time slot of process we need to identify. Why? Because the process need to be stored in main memory. So whether the space is available in the main memory or not, need to identify. If space is not available, that information is stored in the secondary storage. There is no direct contact information from CPU to the secondary. In between, we are having some main memory and cache memory details. Okay, so the user level programs can be stored in the main memory. If there is no space in the main memory, that details is going to be stored in secondary. Whenever CPU place requests the details regarding secondary, then main memory is going to main memory is going to take the details from secondary to the main, just with the support of our swap in swap out operations. With respect to main memory, we need to define swap in and swap out. Okay, what actually swap in the sense, in itself represents we are loading details in main memory. Swap out in the sense, with respect to our main memory, we are deleting the details from main memory and we are storing it. We are writing the details in the secondary storage itself. Whatever it may be, we are having some limited amount of space in main memory. So that's why we are going to consider the secondary storage details also. Okay, this is some information related to process management and as well as memory. Okay, along with these two, you need to know what is file management, IO management, and what is device management, all this. But among these functions, the first two are very, very important. Okay, in further units, each and every function can be treated as one particular unit. In that, we are going to learn in detail specification. So how the process is executed in the sense, with the help of some scheduling algorithms itself. how many number of schedulings we are having, okay, in each and every scheduling, what is the process, okay, how can we read the process and how can we transfer that process information to the CPU. Like that, each and every point of information can be identified. Okay, so from this session, you should learn goals and as well as functions. Thank you.